you, Dr. Rajneesh Saxena, and all the chairpersons for inviting me, and Dr. Bansi Sabu for inviting me in this forum. The topic given today is very important: Charcot's neuroarthropathy. I think in and out, every one of us dealing into diabetic foot care and diabetes care see patients with unilateral or bilateral swelling in the feet. So what we are going to share today is some basic things about Charcot's, the history of Charcot's, and pathophysiology. And what are the basic, the topic given to me is how we can prevent this disease. Because when patient comes with a unilateral arthropathy or unilateral swelling, the first two or three things comes in the mind are that it could be gout, it could be cellulitis, it could be deep vein thrombosis. But keep in back of your mind that if it is going to be a Charcot's, you don't allow this patient to go back from your clinic without doing anything. That is a basic thing, the most important preventive thing, the topic giving to me today, and that we'll discuss now. Charcot's arthropathy, we total see the collapse of the medial arch over here. If you see the patient from here, the whole of the medial arch is touching on the ground. It looks like the foot looks like a A9 iron, the golf stick. So immediately you can see the midfoot collapse, and here you can see the bones on the medial side of the bone foot. And here you can see the varus state of the big toe. That is very important. The whole of the toe goes on the lateral face, and similarly the second toes. This is one of the basic diagnostic criteria when the patient is standing or coming into your clinic. You can just see these patients like this. If you sort of look at the anterior side, whole of the foot surface is available. The plantar surface, even on the dorsum of the foot, the whole swelling is there. The cellulitis is there. So Charcot foot is a devastating bone and joint disease. It is usually misdiagnosed as cellulitis, gout, or deep vein thrombosis, as I've already said about that. Most of the patient, they complain of a painful and also non-painful swelling. This is very important because it is because of the neuropathy. These patients, they don't feel the pain. Swollen foot, which is notably warmer and erythematous. The rocker bottom deformity is a late findings with the Charcot's foot, and this indicates that the physician idly previously missed the diagnosis at some point, or the patient received inadequate treatment, or the patient was not adherent. You and me, we keep on telling to the patient, wear these shoes, wear these offloading shoes, rocker shoes, or the TCC cast, but they are not adherent or compliance is poor. Foot ulcers usually develop at the apex of this osseous deformity, where there could be a maximum plantar pressure, and that which is very difficult to heal these midfoot ulcers. We make the patient to walk over this, and we find out the midfoot ulcers like this, and you can see the high pressure area, the 2D graph and the 3D graph. And until and unless we offload this pressure, whatever technologies we use or whatever techniques we use or healing these wounds or dressings, they will not heal. So offloading is the main answer to healing of this midfoot ulcer or Charcot's ulcer. If we look at the pathophysiology, the prevailing thinking is that the pathophysiology is primarily related to a combination of neurogenic, vascular dysregulation, and repetitive trauma. This is very important because with a collapse of the arch, collapse of the medial arch, the patient keeps on walking in this. The normal patient will have pain, but these patients, because of the neuropathy, they have repeated trauma to the foot. And that's why these patients, they land up with a total collapse of the tarsal, metatarsal morphology. The relationship between increased vascularity and bone resorption may lead to a reduced focal bone mineral density, and this predisposes one to the fracture. So mainly the fractures occur at the tarsal, metatarsal joints. And dislocation can also occur in these patients. So if you see over here, not a total tarsal, metatarsal joint morphology, you can see over here, you can see the Charcot's ankle over here. And many of the patients, they present like this when they come to the clinic. If you look at uncontrolled inflammation, which results from an inciting trauma in a patient with neuropathy. And this phase causes the release of the pro-inflammatory cytokines, which including the tumor necrosis factor alpha and interleukin 1 beta, which leads to the increased expression of the polypeptide receptor activator of nuclear factor GAPA beta ligand, which is known as RANKL. This RANKL stimulates the maturation of osteoclast and the production of the osteoprotogeren from the osteoblast. This osteoprotogeren is a decoy receptor which antagonizes RANKL. So what happens in Charcot foot is that there's an imbalance of RANKL and osteoprotogeren, which leads to the increase in the ratio of osteoclast. And because of that, bone resorption occurs. So osteoclasts are the condition where the most of the bone resorption occurs, and we see all of the tarsal joints and the metatarsal joints at the bases, they get absorbed because of the imbalance between the rankle and the osteoprotegerin. This is how most of the patient, you can see the total resorption of the bone because of the osteoclast activity has occurred. Here in this photograph, you can see the total disalignment of the metatarsal shafts. This occurred because no offloading has been done in this patient, and they keep on walking on this because of the neuroarthropathy. And because of this, and a lot of surgical intervention is required, and you can see a lot of metal wear here inside, the screws, the nails, the K-wires. All Charcot's reconstructive surgeries are done at a higher, bigger center and few centers in India. And then, but the results, again, we will discuss later on that what are the results of the surgical versus conservative pathophysiology for these ulcers. If we look at essential diagnostic insights, Charcot foot, patient present as a red hot swollen foot in a patient with neuropathy. Usually there's a temperature difference of 4 degrees to 10 degrees from the other foot. This is very important. With a laser thermometer, we should always take the temperature from the other foot and see that this is a unilateral hot swollen foot. So the first condition which comes in our mind is Charcot foot, and we should always offload this patient and immediately put this patient into a TCC cast. If there's an inflammation present, Charcot foot will be active. If there's no inflammation, the Charcot foot will be inactive. So when the patient comes in the face of cellulitis or hot swollen foot, our goal should be to convert this active Charcot to an inactive Charcot. And usually 2 to 3 weeks of time is required when the patient is offloaded properly with a TCC cast, and then the active Charcot will convert into an inactive Charcot. X-ray is very important. We should immediately diagnose that. And MRI. MRI allows the detection of the subtle changes in the marrow and can be positive when X-rays are always, sometimes they are normal. And then we can even go for nuclear scanning or PET scans or sulfur chloride barrel scans. They are also helpful in some of the cases, but I think X-ray and MRI are sufficient enough to make our diagnosis. So MRI is very good in differentiating Charcot's foot with osteomyelitis. This is also very important because sometimes or many times osteomyelitis also occurs in the Charcot's foot ulcer, which has occurred. But there's always a deformity. That deformity is rare with osteomyelitis, where deformity is more with Charcot joint. Osteomyelitis affects on one bone, where Charcot affects on the several bones. And osteomyelitis usually occurs in the toes or the forefoot, where more of the injury occurs. Sufficient enough area, where Charcot foot mainly occurs in the midfoot and the ankle area. So these are some of the differentiating points between osteomyelitis and Charcot's foot. But MRI can give us a good diagnosis. There's a task force offered the diagnostic recommendation that inflammation is very important, which plays a key role in pathophysiology of Charcot foot. Occurrence of acute foot or ankle fractures or dislocation in a neuropathic foot is always active in Charcot's foot. X-ray should be the initial imaging, and in the absence of radiographic finding, MRI or nuclear imaging should be done. So these are the task force recommendations for the diagnostic criteria. So clinical diagnosis along with X-rays and MRI should be done immediately when you see a unilateral Charcot foot. I'm very importantly, many times I'm saying unilateral because this is one condition which we really miss that in our clinical practices. And even patient comes to us and we ask them, patient says that my physician or my doctor has told me to walk. So they keep on walking on this unilateral hot swollen foot. And this is the condition where these patients, they land up with maximum fractures, and then we can't save these patients from amputation. The most important immediate treatment for active is the offloading. So they are total contrast cast, embolizes the foot of the and offload the foot. Certain condition, we can even give them a cast walker. So nearly 30% of the patient with Charcot foot, they have bilateral Charcot's foot also. So we have to be very cautious that these patients, because they tend to transfer the weight from the other foot to the another to the other on the contralateral foot, and that's why they develop contralateral or bilateral Charcot's also. Treatment goal, there are some studies on pharmacological therapies to arrest the active Charcot foot. Bifosphonate, just as pemidronate and alendronate, have shown benefit in some of the small studies. Pemidronate is a single dose intravenous infusion. Alendronate is a once weekly oral therapy. A recent large population study from UK have showed that we don't have much benefits for bifosphonates. Intranasal calcitonin is also being used, and patients spray the calcitonin in the nostril once daily, once in the right nostril and other day they in the left nostril, like that. And this advocates have theorized that it is a better treatment for bisphosphonate because it has a direct action on the Rankel osteoprotegerin pathway. So this should be one of the diagnostic criteria and in the treatment goal for these patients. But I will say that offloading of the foot and embolization are the most important treatment recommendation for active Charcot foot, because we can really prevent this. We can stop it, stop the further destruction of the foot at that time. Protective weight bearing is required by which we have by clutches or orthotic or shoes or braces. Anything can be given to this. But I think total contrast cast, I think all the delegates in this forum should be knowing about this total contrast cast, so don't want to go into detail. But I think the moment you see a unilateral port, advise the patient, counsel the patient, give them assurance that you have to offload this port. Otherwise, you will destroy it. By the time you get the MRI or other diagnostic conditions, you should offload this foot, so patient should not go out of your clinic without getting a TCC cast. It could be, I'm saying it could be gout, it could be cellulitis, it could be deep vein thrombosis, but at least you are thinking of Charcot's foot in the, at an initial case. So there are some indication and non-indication. We don't want to discuss into this, but sometime when we remove the plaster or remove TCC cast after 2 weeks or 3 weeks, we should shift this patient into these removable cast workers like AFOs. These are very important in Charcot's foot, because, and we should keep it in the clinic or refer this patient to the centers where AFOs are available, because this will reduce the pressure on the middle of the foot area. Because when the patient is walking, as the patient walking, the foot, the pressure goes from the heel to the middle part. With this cast worker, it directly shifts from the hind foot to the forefoot area. So there will be no pressure in the middle part of the foot here. And this is the criteria that we have to offload the tarsal metatarsal joint on this push. Lot of time patients comes with this midfoot technology, midfoot ulcers. We can apply this Deaconess felted foam techniques. We can make a window and you can see a thick felt pads can be given. But in this, we have to give them an AFO. This is called an rocker sole AFO, where the patient's pressure shifts from the hind area directly to the forefoot area. There will be no pressure in the middle part of the foot, and these type of rocker sole sandals should be given to the patient if they are having a midfoot ulcers. Lot of rocker bottom deformity. Again, this needs a good, a great time to discuss this. Forefoot rocker or double rocker or negative heel rocker. But what you can discuss with your podiatrist or your ONP people, they can give you a rocker sole modification. So this is a condition, even when the ulcer has healed, we should give them a rocker sole sandal. So rocker sole sandal is one of the best sandals or best shoes to be given to the patient in the healing phase, or when the patient has converted from active Charcot to inactive Charcot. So these are one of the most preventive pathologies, preventive methods by which we should prevent this patient from getting dystrophy. Because I think 10 patients get Charcot, 6 or 7 patients will land up into a below knee amputation. So there are some task force recommendation on surgical treatment that panelists agree that one should reserve surgery for cases of severe instability, non-bracable deformity, infection, or failed ulcer healing. This is very important. If we are doing dressings, and the ulcer is not healing, we can go for a surgical treatment. The panel also agreed that surgery could be the primary treatment for Charcot arthropathy of the ankle, since the outcome for ankle treatment are still poor. So we have to discuss this also. So surgical intervention when there's an inactive Charcot. So you can see an ulcer over here on the plantar surface or on the medial arch, and there's an infective osteomyelitis has occurred, we should consider into the going for a surgical intervention. The goal of surgery should be to create a more stable plantigrade foot that one brace with a shoe or a Charcot orthotic walker, which is Crow, and that heals any ulcer. So that would be a goal, that the ulcer should heal. We should take care of the osteomyelitic bones, and then we should make a plantigrade walkable foot. That is more important. That goal of the surgical treatment should be this. There are a lot of surgical techniques of Achilles lengthening tendoning or gastrocnemius tendon reduces the forefoot pressure, arthrodesis, severe Charcot of the ankle joint. We need to discuss for this. And there are a lot of surgical techniques, which I think we need not to discuss over here. But yes, you should keep in the mind when your medical management is not proper or patient is not compliant with this, we need to think of a surgical management with osteomyelitis in the foot. The Charcot foot is a complex complication of diabetes and neuropathy. We should have a heavy index of suspicion when examining a neuropathic patient having a hot swollen foot. Offloading is the most important initial treatment. One should reserve surgical treatment for cases in which offloading and bracing has failed or in case of severe instability. In those cases, we should consider for surgical treatment. Jean-Martin Charcot, MD, concluded his seminal paper on diabetic orthopathies, which bear his name, with the statement "Sira continues," which means to be continued. And more than 130 years now, the statement still remains. So there's much to learn about the pathophysiology of the disease, and it requires a lot of therapies, a lot of research is going on, and we still are at a phase where we have to learn a lot of things. But the only thing in Charcot Foot is saying that we as a clinician or a diabetologist, as a physician or diabetic foot specialist, we should keep in mind that when we see a hot swollen foot, we need to think of this first photograph, that most of these patients will go into below knee amputation, and our goal should be we need to prevent amputation in this patient. And the only preventive method in preventing this amputation is offloading, offloading, and offloading. You go on for treatment, for medical management, for surgical management. That is the second part of your treatment. The first goal is offloading, offloading, and offloading, whatever you have. So final thought, that Charcot is have a very significant negative quality on the patient. Predictor of mortality is at 5 years follow-up. Surgical reconstruction is a lengthy process and have problems. No prospective studies exist which compares conservative to surgical care. No prospective studies still exist comparing various surgical procedures, like we have to go for orthodesis or arthroplasties or tendoaxial lengthening. Lot of surgical correction, we don't have much prospective studies. Older case series involve internal fixation. Most recent involves the external fixation or along with the internal fixation. Current literature does not support one form of fixation over another. No prospective studies exist comparing reconstruction to amputation. Even if we go for an amputation, we know the mortality rate is too high for these patients. Role of Chopard and SIME amputation is underappreciated. So prospective multi-center international registry is still needed. And that's why I said that even 130 years from this condition, which has been diagnosed, it is still that to be SIRA, that we still need more research on this disease. And really, we need to prevent amputation in these patients. Thank you so much.